Woo!
Come on, everybody. Oh, you got it, Chris. You got it. Get the Zoom effects going. Good morning, everybody. Let's kick this thing off. How's everybody doing?
Doing well. Despite the Cleveland weather here in Ottawa. Cold and dreary.
Hello, Cleveland. I always wanted to say that.
Yeah. Oh, boy.
Outside of Texas.
No kidding. So we're going to do a switcheroony here because we actually have three guests this week. And Brent, we're going to kick Brent out. Brent's going to leave us for a bit. And we're going to bring Kevin in since Kevin's sitting waiting for us. So let's do that before we do anything further. So, Kevin, forewarned, we are about to invite you in.
All fix right. Your hair.
That's right. Blow on your wine so that people think you have a hot drink, as Karl just shared that with us. Lots of highs going on in the chat there.
Yeah.
Good morning to everybody. And we'll see. We'll get Kevin in here too in RP. Do you know what? Let's fill up the gap time for a second by allowing you guys to introduce yourselves. We do have three marvelous guests with us here this morning. We have Karl Kapp and Deb Thomas with us on the screen currently, waiting for Kevin Thorn to join us. So maybe we'll start with Karl. Karl, give us the quick 30-second bio of yourself, just so folks know who you are in case they haven't bumped into you before.
So Karl Kapp, I'm a professor of instructional technology at Bloomsburg University in Bloomsburg, Pennsylvania, one of the 14 state universities in Pennsylvania, although that's shrinking. We're going to have a consolidation here in the next couple of years, which will be interesting. And I do a lot of work in games and gamification, and do some work in microlearning, and basically all around interested in the design, development, and delivery of online instruction.
Very cool. And down in the bottom corner for me, I don't know how everybody else is seeing the display this morning. Maybe everybody's else, shuffled. It's random. It's gamified, in fact. Deb, give us your introduction here.
Yeah, so I'm Deborah Thomas, Silly Monkey Serious Games, and I've been doing them for 15 years under Silly Monkey. And before that, I was sneaking them into my corporate work when I was in a corporate employee. And so I love figuring out ways to make things more engaging. And so that's me.
Very cool. And down to my lower right corner, Kevin, tell us about yourself, since you've never been on our show before.
Good morning, everybody. Happy Wednesday. Kevin Thorn, I run a Nuggethead Studios custom e-learning design, illustration, comics company, and teach similar to Karl Kapp, although I've not quite grown up to be like Karl yet, but I am teaching at the University of Memphis in instructional design and technologies. And I recently started the semester in my own doctoral program, so perhaps one day I will grow up to be just like Karl.
We all aspire.
You want to be better, trust me.
I don't know. The bar is pretty high to start with there, Karl. So. So we have a reason why we have all three of you together. Last year, the three of you organized, I'm going to call it a conference, but maybe you'll disagree with me on that word, but an event. Let's go with event. How about that? Called Step Away, where you brought people together into one location. It was Florida, right? There we go.
Kevin's right, got
the button going on. To look at things like designing games and game-related things, et cetera. But I think with an overall arch that mostly targeting people who do work in our own e-learning and instructional design space. And of course, you've been working towards doing something like that again this year in the year of COVID. And those plans have changed, et cetera. But I think what you've described in the past is that a fundamental sort of aspect of what you guys are trying to not only just teach people how to design a game from a sort of pragmatic perspective, but just getting people to exercise their creativity overall, et cetera. And that's what we wanted to talk about a lot today here. Our official title, Can Creativity Be Taught and Used to Solve Problems? I think a lot of people think, well, I'm not creative. And maybe it's because they look at their, you know, buddy who's, you know, who's, I don't know, a painter or somebody who's a musician, and we go, oh, I don't have that talent. And I think sometimes maybe people think that there's something inherent in creativity, maybe something that you're born with, and you either have it or you don't. And yet our title today suggests that maybe that's not the case. So who wants to maybe start in on that?
Hey, I will. I love that you used the word exercise, because I do feel like there's something to that, that you need to practice it just like you do, you know, exercise. It helps you build that muscle, if you will, and helps you get more flexible as well. So I think it is a lot like exercise. And I think, you know, exercise is one of those things that you like put away sometimes. Well, I'll speak for myself. I put it away sometimes, and then going back to it is kind of like, I don't want to exercise. But I think everything that is kind of like that is, you know, habit forming. And so I love that you said exercise. Yeah. Mm. Creativity is something you can work on and should work on.
I think one of the interesting things, I tell a story sometimes, my son, when he was much younger, I don't know, they were having an art class or something, and they had a scribble exercise, and he got points taken off for his scribble. And I'm like, are you kidding me? So I think everyone's very, very creative and has creative elements. Like Deborah said, you exercise those, but if you buy into the system and stay with the system, you get labeled creative and you guys go off in this direction. And then everybody else is like, here, not creative. And the truth is, we're all creative. And as Deb said, if we exercise our creativity, then we can become more creative. And that's our goal, is to help people realize that they're all creative in one way or another.
So let's stick with that, the goal then, and why we're doing this, because the being able to, I guess, be creative, and the second half of our title today, solving problems. Let's go down that path for a little bit. And then I want to circle back, and, you know, probably people in our group here today are going, well, yeah, you say that, but I'm not really creative. So how do I become creative? How do I, you know, flip that switch? So we'll circle back in a bit to maybe, you know, cracking into that creativity mode and things that people might be able to take advantage of there. But let's stick with the taking creativity further and talking about solving problems with it then.
Yeah, right. So, I mean, think about all the problems. Let's just step away from our see what I did there? Step away. Step away from our world, our industry, our work life, and just think of problems that we solve almost daily. And when we look at a problem, then we start pulling in past experiences, retrieve information that we already know about it. We may not have all of the solutions ready for that problem. So then we go research, right? We go, whatever it is, we go to YouTube, we go ask friends. It's like, hey, have you ever done this before? Can I get some advice on this? And then we formulate a plan, and then we solve the problem. So the steps are there. They're fundamental. We all know that. We've been doing it our whole lives. We get into our work life, we get into learning problems, then sometimes we get all that extra noise, all those other distractions, all those noise gets in the way, and then I don't know how to solve this problem. And then that that creativity part comes in there, and then, like you said, we'll circle back to that. But it's interesting that there's a solution for every problem. How do you creatively approach that problem and then come up with an effective solution? And that's the goal of Step Away, is we teach you through that creative process, specifically on a learning problem.
We actually ask them to bring their problem.
Bring your own learning problem.
Bring your learning problem, and we will work through it. You will have a solution by the end of our session, our event, and that is what we do.
Mm-hmm. And the underlying premise is that creativity is a process. And if you can tap into that process, so the myth a lot of people have is that, Brent talks about the easy button. A myth a lot of people have about creativity is, well, two myths. One is, I'm not creative because I can't do whatever. And the second is that creativity comes to you in a moment of zen, and then instantly, shazam, you've got this creative idea and you start working on it. And creativity for all of us, sometimes it works like that, but rarely. What really works is you sit down and you put in the effort to do that. So a lot of times people say to me, Karl, how do you write a book? And I like kind of one word at a time, right? You just write down one word, then you write down another, and pretty soon you have three words and four words, et cetera. And it's somewhat a flippant answer, but it's also somewhat true, because a lot of times if we force ourselves to do part of that activity, then we can get into the flow or the draw. So, you know, I do things like, if I have a writer's block, for example, I'll literally write this down. I have a writer's block. I have no idea what I'm supposed to be writing right now. I'm supposed to be writing about instructional strategies, but I have no idea how to start. And pretty soon, halfway through the paper, I've started talking about instructional strategies, which is what I needed to do. And so that process is something that we feel can be replicated, can be practiced, can be focused on desirable outcomes. And so that's what we try to, you know, I hate this word, but we try to socialize the idea among people that, yeah, we can definitely do that.
Yeah, there's a couple. Yeah, it's interesting you say that, Karl, because I'm the same way with my art. Sometimes I have a specific drawing that I need to do for a customer or a client, and I have no idea how to start. So I just start drawing lines. I say, well, let me just draw a rabbit and see what happens after I draw a rabbit. And then, oh, look, here's a dinosaur. Neither one of those things, but I just keep drawing and moving lines until something happens. And, that creative process, I'm kind of watching the chat where we talk about vulnerability and a sense of play. And there's so many things going on in chat right now that just my head is blown up.
That's good.
Creativity has been somehow socialized, I think, Karl, you mentioned, or systematically lumped into somebody who has talent or is artistic, whether it be a painter, a musician, an artist, a writer, and that you have creativity because you do those creative things. And that's a myth. I'll debunk that right away. The artistic side of things is just we continue to practice after the age of seven. Most people stop playing their music, you know, in their teens, or they stop drawing after art class, you know, their art class in high school, and then they stop practicing. That's not to say they're not creative, and that's not to say they don't have a talent. It's just they stop practicing. So here's the idea of, let's take what you already know, the creativity within you, and let's teach you how to exercise, as Deborah said, exercise that creativity, and then teach you a process, and then it'll come back out. And it's as natural, you'd be surprised how natural it is once you learn the tips on getting it back out.
I recall somewhere in the past few years anyway, a quote going around, and I'm completely drawing a blank on who it was from, et cetera. But the idea being that creativity or genius or invention, that making something new basically doesn't come out of nothing, but it typically comes out of combining other things, mashing things together or seeing ways to add on to existing things. And that's how new things, you know, come about, which is kind of, I think, did we use the lightning bolt reference, you know, bolt out of the sky of an inspiration thing? That almost then leads us back to a process of, Kevin's drawing things and eventually drawing things together, pull something new forward out of as a part of a process. So
I always talk about creativity being the juxtaposition of two things that you don't think should go together. Mm. And when you kind of combine them, and that's why it's really valuable, so I think it's really interesting. So for example, Jackson Pollock, right? So he did painting, and he literally threw paint on canvas, and voila, that's somehow art, right? But it is, because what you have to understand is the greater context in which it takes place. So in Jackson Pollock's time and growing up, the trend was as realistic as you could possibly be, as photorealistic as you could possibly be. And Jackson said, hey, in all this context, what happened to freedom? What happened to expression? What happened to movement? And so when he did that on the canvas, that's what he was rebelling against. So he was juxtaposing today's art with the concept of freedom and color and like all that kind of stuff. So when you think about being creative, it's helpful to have a bigger context. So for example, if you're an L&D, you can't just read L&D stuff. Maybe you should read some stuff about biology or about business or about plants. You can't just think about what you think about. Read comics, right? So I think part of what we talk about is opening up your experiential channels and get information from different places. And then you can say, you know, a comic would go really well. A comic book sequence of pains would go really well with this instructional concept of compliance. And now let me try to put them together, right? So that's kind of what we think about the process. So part of what we talk about is opening up those channels so that you can get them from a lot of different places.
Mm-hmm. Brent was asking in the, or suggesting in the chat that maybe we could work through or talk about one of the activities or an exercise that you would, that you might use to help people unlock their creativity. And there were a number of thumbs up for that too. So that seems like a popular request.
Lego.
Okay.
Surprisingly.
Why don't you walk through? Yeah. Like how's that work?
Yeah. So Lego Serious Play is a set of methodologies that you solve problems or answer questions by building a 3D metaphorical model. You tell metaphorical stories through Lego. So this is not following Lego instructions and building a Lego kit. There's nothing, not even close. Same brick, same colors, same Lego brick, but every participant gets the exact same inventory. And if you register for Step Away, we're going to send you a little treasure chest, and in that treasure chest, we'll have your own very own personal Lego that you can participate with. And then what we do is we'll ask a very deep thinking question, just some question. For instance, as Deborah mentioned, anybody that comes, you bring your learning. What learning problem are you wanting to solve? And we're going to take you through the creative process to develop a card game that is the solution to that learning problem. So the solution is a deck of cards. The learning problem is what you bring, and how we get there, there's a process. And Lego Serious Play is part of one of the first activities where we say, what does your learning problem look like? If you were to see it sitting on the table as a model, what does it look like? And here's your very limited, restricted number of Lego brick. Put that together and then tell me a story of what that looks like. What happens in that exercise, and it's a very short, just 3 or 4 minutes. What happens in that exercise is because the restrictions and the limitations that are put on you forces you down a path to be creative and focus on what the solution is or focus on what the answer is. And that single activity will unlock. And then Karl mentioned it earlier about play and getting into that zone or getting into the flow. And then next thing you know, your brain is unlocking some neurons that you didn't even know it had. And then we use that exercise several times, you know, throughout the workshop to kind of relook at things. And then we back up and go through some other exercises. But Lego is a huge part, or play, just play, will unlock. If you're struggling with trying to figure out something, go play. And it doesn't necessarily mean Lego, but just go play. I don't know if you can see behind me, I got Tinker Toys I got out right now. I'm playing with Tinker Toys. So,
And what strikes me about that is that's something that's repeatable. You could take that Lego out anytime, and you could do that same kind of an exercise on your own, at least, you know, as a way of getting started. So we're tapping into creativity without necessarily saying, go to a museum and look at paintings. It's still focused on and involving the problem, but it's getting your getting you into a process to be able to start thinking about solving that. That's really cool.
Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
Go ahead.
Just go get one of these little boxes from the department store. It's a random. It's not a particular kit. It's just like a 12-in-1 kind of thing. And it comes with a little book, but it's just a nice little box to pick up and start playing with random pieces. And it really helps, even if you're struggling with how to respond to an email, start playing with Lego, and it'll.
And we're living in a very interesting time where I think people who maybe even don't think they're creative are having to exercise their creativity. So many folks have shifted into, you know, new contexts of trying to provide something called a learning experience, particularly for those folks who've been traditionally, you know, in a face-to-face kind of environment, and now they're shifting online. And you're handed a set of tools potentially, whether that's an LMS or an authoring tool or a web presentation tool like this, and it's got rails, it's got structures and things like that, and yet you still want to achieve things that you start thinking about, well, how can I bend it? How can I break it? How can we adapt it, I guess, to this new context? And so I think there's a lot of folks in our industry who are having to really, really stretch their creativity and work that creative muscle a lot harder than maybe in the previous couple of years if you've been in a certain particular career path, for example.
Yeah, and I think what's so cool about using creativity to, you know, kind of bust through some of those things is that when you do it, you get so inspired and so excited about your ideas that it gives you this new energy. And then, you know, to me, then that's win-win-win, because you are loving what you're doing, your participants are loving what they're learning, and the organization is benefiting from it as well, because everybody's producing and happy. So yeah, creativity is
if you're with us today and you're struggling or you're trying to figure this out on your own, two words, just think of what I saw the one word in chat, Toronto said tinker. Just tinker. That's why they're called tinker toys. You tinker with toys and just fiddle. I like to fiddle with brick. And you remember the fiddle spinner that came out, the big fad several years ago?
Oh, yeah, the fidget spinners, right?
Yeah, the fidgets. Yeah. So fidget, fiddle, tinker. And if you just, I don't know, pick up a box of pencils and just fiddle. Or, you know, the old deck of cards where you make a card house. Just do something with your hand. Think with your hands. Put your computer away, shut the lid, step away from the technology, and think with your hands. Fiddle, tinker, play. And I'll promise you, something will happen in your brain that you didn't know was there.
Well, and that's what's so cool about that Lego exercise, starting with that and like trying to think through your problem, because a lot of times at the beginning of a problem is that all you can do is think about the problem. It's a problem. And you think of all the negative parts of it. But that activity, because of the debrief and the actions that you take during the activity, you get to explain like what the problem, just explaining the problem out loud is, you know, just a really cool outcome of that little bit of work that we do and step away.
Yeah. It strikes me that something that we often feel faced with in our work life is the expectation that we have an answer already. Well, here's the problem. What's the answer? And, you know, that sense of being put on the spot or that got to solve it now. But even the phrase step away suggests there's a lot of value in just putting it off to the side and letting it either percolate or doing something else to try to trigger something that will bring you, perhaps bring up a better solution. I have a joke in my own mind. It's the shampoo effect, right? You wake up the next morning, you have a shower, and as you're in the shower, you realize, oh, wait, we could try this or we could try that. And lather, rinse, repeat, inspire. No, but that idea of, and knowing full well that your brain has been percolating on it for a while, and it's just going to take a bit of time for that for something to pop up to be able to maybe think about doing it differently or trying something else with it. So
yeah, and I think from a neuropathway, you know, if we want to get in a little bit of the neuroscience, I don't want to get too deeply, but basically, when we focus on a problem and focus, we only have one neural pathway to the problem. Mm. When we don't focus on it, our minds can take more neural pathways to get there. And traveling through the pathway, it's kind of like walking down, you know, meandering through a neighborhood. Oh, there's a bookstore. Oh, there's a coffee shop. Oh, there's a game shop. You know, and you kind of bring all those to the problem and it helps you to solve the problem. So it really is kind of like a walkabout in your mind, but it's unconscious. And the interesting thing to me in terms of thinking about applying this to work and work problems is that And we do this in workshops all the time, is we say, oh, we only have these people for 8 hours. We better give them 9 hours of information, right? Or, oh, we have a 1 hour Zoom session. They're not going to get any value out of it if we don't stuff it full of. But actually, it's fascinating. There's actually research that shows that people that students, these are college students, who are in active learning, and we know active learning is a better way to learn because you're doing something, you're applying your hands, you're solving problems. But if you ask students, hey, active learning versus passive learning, you know, lecture, where did you learn more? Students will say, oh, I learned more in the lecture. But the results are, no, you learn more in active learning. So as we become adults, we think, oh, okay, if we absorb a lot of information, we're learning. If we produce a lot of information, we're producing quality stuff. Turns out it's counterintuitive. We actually need to produce less at a higher quality, and then we'll have more bang for our buck. And we need to be more active, cover less content, but more in depth from a learning perspective. So it's just really fascinating how, and I don't know if it's cultural or if it's indoctrinated or whatever, but we actually have a very wrong view of how we develop long-term learning and long-term application. So spreading it out over time, you know, the space practice and space retrieval and all that kind of stuff works, but it also works on being really active in doing something and then stepping away and then coming back.
Mm-hmm. That time for reflection that lets you add more to it and to evolve it and to continue the process. Go ahead, Deb.
Yeah, I was going to say, and that's, you know, we start with these Lego activities. We do several of them that kind of get you to that point of like, oh, I see my problem so clearly. I can articulate it. I understand the inside outside issues that I need to work on. And then we one of our attendees called it hard fun, because then we go through other activities that are also really kind of difficult to think through, but when you break through, it's so exciting. Like just some of the visualization stuff that Kevin takes us through is also like, you think you can't draw, so that makes you think, I can't, why, how can I even consider making a comic or whatever it is I might want to make, even a card game, because it takes artwork and so forth. But he breaks through some of those things, and the whole session is about that. We use different activities to kind of break through different parts, and by the end we have you know, the outcome. Like someone said in the chat, that yeah, it doesn't matter that it's cards at the end. It is breaking through the problem with an outcome that is usable, that maybe can even be turned into other things as well.
Yeah. Now this is totally off subject, but there's a fly flying around me, so I'm trying to see if I can get it to land on my head. So if you see it, don't say anything.
No, just we'll take a screenshot.
I'm hoping fingers are crossed, but we'll see what happens.
I got the Zoom set up. We'll just draw right in on it.
Yeah. I'm ready to go viral on the tweeting with it.
Oh boy.
All right.
You're bad.
So Taruna has thrown a formal question in the question panel. There's a whole whack of stuff going on in the chat, and I'm having trouble being there and being here, because holy man, it's one of the most active chats that we've had going in a while. But Taruna is asking in the question feature, I find that we are continuously trying to be active. What are your thoughts about boredom and our willingness to sit with boredom for a bit to foster creativity?
Start tinkering, play. Seriously, I mean, how many times have you let's say gardening, clipping weeds, or in the shower, you know, you're washing your hair, washing your face, or you're just doing something, but your brain is thinking, your brain is still working, and you have those little aha moments. Oh yeah, that's a good, oh, I'm going to go do that. Or you're out, I don't know, you're just doing something with your hands, again, thinking with your hands, and for some odd reason, oh, I think I'm inspired to go make banana pudding this afternoon. But where did that come from? And it comes from that inside. So the idea of being bored, and that's a real thing. I mean, it's I've been bored. I mean, we've all been bored. What do you do when you're bored? I play. I've got a house, a studio full of toys, and toys from the, you know, the expensive robotic stuff all the way down to Lego or Tinker Toys. So, and then I was somebody in the chat, and I can't remember who it was.
Well, Lego ain't cheap.
Yeah.
Not anymore. It used to be.
Well, I would say that if you go like Facebook Marketplace, there are people selling their you know, grandkids Lego from, and they'll just sell a big pile of it. And you can go, you get $20, you get 10, 15 pounds. If you're just looking for loose brick to play with, you get it pretty expensively. But I saw somebody in the chat a little while ago said that they had a pile of color pencils at their desk, and they just literally, while we were talking, picked it up and laid them out and started playing with the color pencils, like lining them up and whatever. And it was, and she just admitted that it just, oh my gosh, it just happened, you know, that unlocking.
Right.
I think boredom is really important. I think I believe there's no learning without reflection. Otherwise, it's just an experience. So one of the things that boredom allows you to do is subconsciously reflect. And I believe we do a lot with subconsciousness that we don't even think about. That didn't make sense. But anyway, there's a lot going on subconsciously.
It's
that
a t-shirt, though. I'm going to use it.
But I don't think about it. But it's awareness. So how we define boredom. So sometimes, you know, I used to, one of the things I used to do is when I got one of my earlier jobs, I would literally, when I was trying to work on something, I would literally get out, stand up from my desk and go sit down in the guest chair and just sit there. And my boss would go by and go like, Karl, what are you doing? Like, why are you just sitting there? And because I was thinking about or just being allowing myself to be bored, and ideas would come or thoughts would come or go stare out the window. Like, what are you staring at? I don't know. And just like looking out the window. So some of those active measurements to change position, to literally change perspective, to, you know, the Japanese do this thing called forest bathing, where they'll walk through the forest, kind of absorbing the nature around them. So I think if we're rush, 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 do, 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 produce, 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 we'll eventually produce this way. So if we have elements of boredom, not only from problem solving, but our own mental health and awareness, it's good to be bored. It's good to sit around. I know, you know, we probably all know people that can't be alone with themselves because they have to be doing something. You know, if we're all work and no play, when you retire or you're forced to retire, what are you going to do? Like, you need to do something. So I think finding ways to be creatively bored is really, really, really important. In fact, I'm bored now.
It's actually what step away is. That's right. That is the concept of step. It's like getting the noise out and being quiet. And there's very many parts of our event that people are just quietly working. And I think, you know, especially with like Zoom, and people think that everybody needs to be like talking and doing, and you know, you got to do stuff to make sure people are learning. Is no, you got to give them time. You have to be quiet. It's a hard thing to do in a live session as well, because you think that if they're not loud and asking questions and doing stuff, then it's not happening. But actually, that is when it's happening.
Yeah, step away is, if you're interested, step away is all about learning how to be creatively bored.
There we go. It strikes me that there's parallels with this and the ideas around, you know, either being present or being in the moment as well, that there we think about, I mean, we were talking earlier about exercises for creativity. Well, you can practice and try to be, you know, an active listener, try to be present in a moment. There are structures and strategies, you know, the exercises that can help you improve that. And there are also, you know, parallel things, I'm sure, with that we can focus on with either, you know, creativity and that sort of thing too. We're getting sort of towards the end of our time here today. And so I want to talk a bit about the creativity that you guys have had to put in place or work on, et cetera, as you thought, take this thing called Step Away, which was a bunch of people living for a week together in a house. And now in the era of COVID, you know, what's the creativity that was involved in trying to do something that's either based on that or and different, et cetera. What's happened for you guys in that process?
It's really exciting because we're taking this, we're going to give people the very same experience in a lot of ways where they get to go through all sorts of fun activities that will have results in good outcomes and usable products at the end, but in online, right? So we're doing part of it in a 3D world. And we have so many rooms in this space that we'll be moving in different and going into different places at different points during this. It's a 4-week event. And we'll, sometimes we even have a Lego room. Well, we can't call it Lego. It's called bricks. And
a block room, bricks.
And we have an escape room, and which we did in the house because that house was a game house. It had all these rooms with different games. Well, we have a game room as well with Connect Four and different things. And we have lecture space and also there's so many. It's amazing. We have flip charts that we can use. And then we also are going to do parts of it with Zoom. And or I'm not sure if Zoom is our final choice yet, but yeah, we don't know. We're still working some of that.
It's 3D virtual space. It's conversations like we're having right now. Then as Karl mentioned, there's a lot of pockets of reflection time and your own assignments. So you're not online all the time. We get online, it's every day, but I think if I look at the agenda is posted out on the site, but it's 3 days a week, you get online with us where we kind of walk through things, have discussions, you ask questions. And then there's the other couple days is where you work on your own, but we're available. So we're available 5 days a week for a month. At these kind of like office hours, if you will, there's pockets of time that if you need help with something, we can come online. But then it's basically you have to do the work. It's your creativity and you do the work. What we'll talk to you and coach you through is during these times is when you step away from all your digital. You have to find a place as if we were in that physical place where we were last year, where there's no technology. You have to step away from all that in order to get this creativity working. And so we walk you through that whole process. And then we have a big show and tell at the end, right?
Right, yeah.
Very cool.
And then we actually take your work and get it the artwork in place on the cards, publish it, and send it to you. I mean, how cool is that?
Very cool. Something that you could add to your shelf behind yourself in your upcoming online calls.
Well, what Denver just said, that was one of the things that, you know, we've attended, all of us, I think, have experienced a pre-conference workshop or gone to a weekend workshop or seminar. You get this enormous wealth of information. And then you walk out of there, you know, inspired and you're all excited and you want to go back and you're trying to, you know, decompress all that information. But to actually put that into practical application when you get back to your workforce, because all that other noise starts coming in and closing in around you. So you never really have the opportunity like you want to create that physical artifact or a tangible product. So the goal with Stepway is that we take you through scratch. You, like we talked about earlier, you bring your learning problem with you. And by the end of the event, you will have a tangible product that is a solution to that problem that you started with. Mm-hmm.
And even if you're like, yeah, but I do online or digital, like what's with the card game? We always talk about proofing of the concept on paper because you can then prototype, automate it so much more easily. So we've gotten away with paper prototyping, and digitally you can't touch anything or feel anything. So doing a paper prototype is just so important. And in fact, it was really interesting. We were working with a card company, Print and Play, and one of our learners, one of our attendees, cards were so impressive, they wanted to feature it on their site. So the results are pretty impressive from that. And then the other thing we thought was, you know, wouldn't it be great, like, if I went to a conference and I just wanted to hang out, like, with one of the speakers and kind of see what they're up to and pick their brain. There's not many opportunities for that. But here we thought, well, here's three people that speak at conferences all the time. So, you know, if you want to talk to them, even if it's not about creativity, if it's about, you know, like, raising kids or mowing the grass or whatever, you now have access during that, you know, time period to, you know, talk and discuss. And sometimes just those informal conversations can be so valuable. So we were really excited about bringing that aspect to the conference.
Yeah, it's all very cool. Very cool. And I think Brent had put the link in earlier. CJ actually put a link in the chat too about to the agenda. Sorry, I just got distracted. Brent's calling.
I love Brent's gas mowers.
Gas mowers.
Do you mean we're full of gas, Brent? Is that what you're saying? Hot air, maybe. Flammable ideas. Yeah. Dumpster fire. All right,
sorry. I think that's one of the that's a Freudian typing slip, maybe. Yeah, taste makes waste. But anyway, awesome. So there's lots of Brent's put the link back in there too, if folks are interested in checking it out a bit more. As we bring ourselves here to wrap up, oh my goodness, I didn't think Brent's not here, so I don't have the music loaded. So we're all going to have to hum. Everybody in the crowd, get your trumpets ready. I guess we'll have to dance out.
Or you can swap me out if.
Yeah, well, maybe we'll bring
the music guy that Brent is. So feel free
Let's bring Brent back in but thanks so
Bye
much
everybody.
For joining
thanks.
Us today, guys. Yeah.
Thanks everybody.
I'm gonna close Karl Thank out. You. I'm gonna find Brent, and we'll bring Brent back in to dance us out of here. Where is Brent?
He's dancing.
He's mowing the grass.
No kidding. There he is. Look, there's a search function in the tool too. There we go.
There he is.
He's back. All
this
right.
This was fun.
Yeah, it's always a hoot. And last year's conversation about this conference was really cool and inspiring. And it's awesome to see how you guys have, exercised creativity to pivot things and shift things and still provide value and impactfulness for the attendees. So thanks so much for joining us here today. And if you've got your contact info, if you want to throw that into the chat, people might be able to reach out to you outside of the context of Step Away. That's awesome too. And Brent, I think it's time to hit the play button on the music and dance out.
I believe it is. This was so much fun. I had a blast in the chat, actually. Yeah. I don't have to just hang out in there all the time.
And that was cool.
You can
that
do
was
the cool. live video stuff, Chris. I'll just hang out in the chat.
Let's do it again. Invite us for back. Sure. We had a lot of fun.
Always.
Yeah, we definitely will for sure. You guys. And did we even get a date? When is the next event?
What's January 11th.
All right. So everybody plan it. Get ready for your January. Put it on your calendars so you can get in on it. Start talking to your managers, all that kind of good stuff, because you got to get approvals and blah, blah, blahs.
Right.
So get on it. And
last plug, we just published the blog post again this morning out on the site. So Step Away Design blog. What came first, inspiration or creativity? Go check it out.
Yes.
We've all got homework now.
Thank you.
Awesome. Thanks again so much. Thanks so much again, guys. And thanks to Karl, who's joining us in the distance
in the mode chat.
Right now in the chat. But have a great rest of your week, guys. Thanks, everybody.
Good grooves. Here we go. Here's the special effects.
It tracks me.